Mbanyasuo he punishes as a Lions found out.
Very true. Kassadin is still up and available. Not anymore. So mid lane bans are being focused for the time being. And there's still a lot of champions up and available in regards to the top lane. So what do Super Hot Crew prioritize? Do they want to get rid of Jax? Or do they want to get rid of a jungle champion? Because all of the junglers are still up.
Let's have a look. Jax taken away as the final ban. Kayle was also removed. And looks like this is going to be a very easy first pick for Rockout. Ziggs left up in the game. We know how strong Ziggs is on multiple fronts, whether that's sieging down towers, whether that's defending towers with his brilliant ability to wave clear. That's going to be the first choice here for Rockout.
And Overpower was the first Ziggs player during the spring split to actually pick up the Spirit of the Spectral Wraith over on his Ziggs in the mid lane, farming up a lot of bonus gold. And we know it's a comfort pick for Overpower. He has played it a whole lot. I'm not 100% sure on this Rengar pick. We know Miner is a Rengar player, but Rengar has been available in the past, and he hasn't actually picked it, so we need to see if this gets locked in.
And Impaler had a big smile on his face for that one as well, so I feel we may be getting drawn into something here that's possibly not going to happen. We'll have to see. Actually, the Super Hot Crew switch away. Going to go with two very strong and safe first picks here. Locking in their duo, Thresh and Lucian.
So the safe option for the Super Hot Crew. All of the junglers are still available. The priority ones of Lee Sin, Elise and Evelynn. So the question is, where do Rocket and Super Hot Crew want to lock in the champions? Shyvana is still up. Irelia is still up. These are champions that both Zazzus and Mima have played in the past. If Selfie wants to play a pick-style game, he could go Twisted Fate. But knowing there's a Ziggs on the other side, it is a difficult lane matchup in the opening stages. We've seen Curb punishing Twisted Fates with Ziggs in the early game. So Selfie may opt to go for something like a Nidalee. It is available, it is still there. If they get some form of disengagement with Thresh, you've got so much time with the Flayers in the box to get multiple Nidalee Spears out. So a lot of time being used by both teams during picks and bans.
And Nidalee already featured for Selfie in that mid lane. The highlight probably the one against the Copenhagen Wolves in week two, where he ended 4-0-10 in that victory. On the other side though, Rockout locking in the jungler, taking Elise here for Jankos. And we'll also see Lulu come in. Expect that at this point to be going maybe into that top lane with Zazzus. We've already seen the fact that Zazzus has experimented a little bit earlier on when it comes to this year and how he's actually played in that top lane with a few more AP champions. See exactly where that lands could, of course, in the end, still fall to Vanda in the support role. But now we go over to the Super Hot Crew. What are they feeling like for this?
Yeah, so Europe are continuing, we believe, the trend of this Lulu top lane. We as a region do it more than many of the other regions. What I do like from the side of Rocket is if they have an aggressive jungler like Elise and they have an aggressive support, maybe a Leona, then that Lulu's going to do quite well. But for the time being, you're really just going to use that Lulu to save somebody that gets caught out because you don't have that tanky frontline. We much prefer seeing a Lulu mid with a beefy initiator like a Shyvana in that top lane. So Rocket going with that double AP, the last couple seconds do round down and Super Hot Crew are not going to put Rengar on the top lane. So a little bit disappointed to see that, but Mima has had a phenomenal summer split on Shyvana. 6 games played, 4 games won, and you've just got all the makings of a pick flank composition, which is what Fnatic ran yesterday. They can come in from the sidelines. If Super Hot Crew want to run Twisted Fate, he would fit very well with that flank opportunity, and it would negate the zoning power that Ziggs and Lulu offers. Or they could also just go for a Nidalee, get some spears, flank and go for team fight. So we'll see what he decides to go.
On the side for Rockout here, locking in a Jinx and possibly Morgana, but Jinx definitely going to be in there. And Jinx is another one of those AD carries that has kind of fallen out of favor. We saw a lot of her in the spring split. Not so much here the case. People focusing mostly on Lucian and Twitch, to be honest.
Yeah, they're definitely the go-to champions. And Rocket have actually banned Twitch in 7 or 8 of their 9 games. They do not want to deal with the champion. It also makes you think Salivar doesn't play the champion because they have banned him a lot, a very high percentage of games. This should be the first time we've seen Salivar and Jinx this split. And I'm a little worried for him because Evelynn should be able to get to him. Shyvana should be able to get to him. And there's a lot of opportunities to get to that back line. So risky play, but there is a fair amount of protection from Lulu, from Morgana, from the zoning Ziggs offers. So Rocket are going to be banking in these team fights on protecting Jinx and allowing Jinx to get all the damage down while Ziggs and Lulu offer zone control. They don't have the strongest of initiation, but I don't think Rocket want to play that game. I think they do want to be a little more reactive and play the poke defending game with the two APs in great range.
So on the other side, the Super Hot Crew's final choice here, looking for a mid laner that will go up against overpowered Ziggs. Orianna, we say this time and time again when we see that, and will actually be locked in a very all-round strong champion is Morgana, with that scaling up into the late game as well.
Yeah, and with the Orianna, you've got safe wave clear, which the Super Hot Crew were lacking. They were relying on the culling. Now you can just put the command attack down and let the ball clear the waves out. So we didn't see the Twisted Fate, who would have given wave clear, but less team fight presence. And I think the Super Hot Crew are looking more for a forced team fight composition, allowing Shyvana and Evelynn to go in from the sidelines. You get a good shockwave on and try to reduce the impact of that Lulu wild growth or the AoE damage that Ziggs offers. But the thing is, if Super Hot Crew don't get good flanks or get good positioning, that shockwave is going to be very difficult to land.
We'll have to see, guys. Well, now that the squads are locked in, you guys have a chance to change your vote somewhat. So tweet at LOL Esports with hashtag ROCWin or hashtag SHCWin, and we'll see if these lineups have managed to sway your votes somewhat. Of course, it was about, I think, 71% in the pregame there. So a big total in favor of the Super Hot Crew. As said, we can't really argue with that now, looking at current form between these two teams. However, you have the chance to change that. I don't think it's going to change too much, though.
I don't think so either. I think the Super Hot Crew have put together a very strong comp. I do think they can split push. I think they've got strong team fight capabilities. But they need to take advantage of the vision game. They need to make sure they get ahead so that Shyvana and Evelynn can come from the sidelines. Soez did a fantastic job yesterday of always finding the right time to jump in with Dragon's Descent against SK. And it's going to be on Mima to do the same thing here against Rockout, because if they don't time it correctly, the Black Shield and the zoning from Ziggs and Lulu, it's going to be very difficult to overpower.
Well, here we go, in-game then, Rockout versus the Super Hot Crew. I think an important game for both sides. Rockout, as I said before, just needs some wins on the board. For the Super Hot Crew, they've had a couple of difficult losses, I think, on the bounce now, where they've had some real troubles being involved and really putting up a fight in their last two encounters. So we'll see if things have been talked about overnight and over the last week and whether they can come out strong here against, honestly, a team that are struggling right now in the league.
Yeah, I think the Super Hot Crew have definitely showed a level up in their mental approach to, you know, objective play and moving around the map, because you can see it very clearly in how they approach the game. If they can force Rocket's hand in a good lane swap early on, they can put Rocket immediately onto the back foot, and it looks like Super Hot Crew with a very focused invade, trying to look for any opportunities. The thing is, Overpowered does have good range in these bouncing bombs, so they're going to take a lot of poke, depending on how long they stick around.
Hot coming out there, and Rocket had already started to move away. However, Mima's been completely separated from the rest of his team. Will he be forced to use a flash here? Yankos going to be chasing in with those spiderlings. The bombs come down, and the first blood is going to land in the lap of Overpower. He's Ignite finishing off the kill there, and well, that's not what you want at level one for the invade. Okay, first blood is not worth the amount right now that it was previously in League of Legends, but first blood is still a first blood, and we can see that Overpower's gone back home to shop, and he's going to have a lot more to work with in lane.
Yeah, grabbed himself a couple of wards. The first blood comes in like 1 minute 20. Yes, you've given over a couple hundred gold to Rocket, but it's not a massive, it's not a game-changing loss. And just as I was praising Super Hot Crew for their objective and their decision-making, they decide to blind invade and get themselves caught out. So not the strongest of moves. I do think it was like a half-hearted invade. Mima was going in, the rest of the team was kind of backing out. So maybe a little bit of miscommunication between the team in regards to what they actually wanted to garner from that play. And we are going to see a lane swap, but it's not 2v1, it's going to be 2v2, and they've just moved the duos to the top lane, and they've left their top laners respectively on the bottom. Mima, no TP, so keep that in mind.
No TP. Zaza's still having his available to him. Also interested to see how Jinx comes in. As you said, first time that we're seeing Jinx here in the summer split, as I mentioned before, was also a big peak back in spring, but since the likes of Twitch have really come to favor, we've been seeing less and less, or no Jinx, actually statistically correct on that front. We'll see. Well, the vote that came up a little bit earlier on, apparently you guys feeling like the Super Hot Crew maybe in a little bit more of an advantage, has actually increased by 1% in the Super Hot Crew's favor.
Every single point counts, I guess, at this stage in the game. I do think that, you know, for Rocket's team composition, there's going to be so much pressure on keeping Seliva alive. Yes, you do have great damage from Ziggs. Yes, you will eventually have good damage from Lulu. But in terms of the team fight presence, because Super Hot Crew are going to be coming from the sidelines, it's going to make Overpower's life very difficult for landing those big Mega Inferno bombs. So if they cannot keep Seliva alive with all of their abilities, Smite fights, oh, Impaler doesn't even have it available, so couldn't have taken that anyway.
Yeah, I think he was hoping that it had taken Jankos a little bit longer there so he could actually challenge for that. Doesn't get it, and that's a nice little cheeky pickup for Jankos on his way out. As we expected here, Overpower doing a great job of farming up in the early stages of this match. 22-17 CS, he leads on that front. Impaler, meanwhile, is on the top side of the map, and we'll see if he actually puts any pressure down onto Seliva and Vander, who actually have all of their summoner spells available. So no massive danger, really, even with Evelynn on that top side.
No, and this goes back to the style of play that is becoming more and more apparent in 4.8 and 4.9 in Europe. It's just these almost straight-up lanes. You are seeing the 2v2s, you're seeing the 1v1s, and it's giving us these extended periods where we can see who is mechanically superior in the laning phase, and then whoever makes the fastest and smartest call to go for the objectives. What we've been seeing from elite jungles in North America in the same time frame is 3, 4, 5 minute dragons when you have elite. You can juggle the aggro very effectively with the spiderlings. And we actually seen yesterday as well, in the last game of the day, if memory serves. So we need to see if Rocket are on the same page, if Rocket can take advantage. Not having the AD carry and support there may mitigate that or lower the risk.
Yeah, I think so as well. Stop them from getting so aggressive on that bottom side of the map at the early stages. This top lane, as you mentioned, the duo's up there, currently 36-32 CS. So Mr. Rawls having a bit of a harder time there. He's had the minions pushed onto his turret for quite a while now, but we will fail it. Starting off with the shield, we'll be able to help him out somewhat with that execute of the minions underneath his own tower. However, this could be interesting. Impaler moving down towards the bottom lane. And with that aggression out of Mima, I thought Zazus may have sniffed out a bit of a problem there. He's been spotted by the tower. Impaler, as he comes around the corner, will he force a flash? Yes, he will. Jankos flashing away. Mima went very, very low, though.
Yeah, the combo, the power of that Glitter Lance catching both Mima and Impaler mitigates the kill threat. But summoner spell burn, so that is a successful gank from Impaler. He has a few minutes where he needs to rinse, repeat, and come back. And once Mima has got access to his ultimate and maybe his first itemization purchase, they may try put some kill pressure. But technically speaking, Lulu is fairly safe against Shyvana, has all the tools to slow him down, turn him into a munchkin, wild growth himself, and get out cleanly. So Zaz is just going to play a little safer in that bottom lane.
I don't think there's much of a problem really overall. We'll see as both TPs are now up, which obviously allows them a bit more of an easy time when it goes to going home, recalling and getting themselves right back into the lane. Currently Mima is leading in CS over the two, so gotta give him some real credit for that one. We mentioned yesterday that at least coming into yesterday's games, his KDA and overall performance very much improved over what we saw of Mima in the spring split.
Yeah, very, very solid tank player. And as the game has continued to evolve, Mima, I think, has kept up with the champion pool available to top laners, as well as the teleport strategy that they need to employ, because he's got some of the best statistics in the region. He's playing Mundo, he's playing Shyvana, and he's playing them to a very high caliber. And if you contrast him to, say, Wicked, you sometimes talk about his champion pool, or Soaz, who maybe isn't the strongest with the teleport usage, he's doing very well. Unsung hero, as it were.
Unsung hero, completely agree with that one. He kind of was just quiet, though. No real hype around Mima, no real negative impact either from him. He was one of those players that somehow gets under the radar all the time, as Vander is going to get himself a pink ward down and is able to get himself a bit of ward clearage going on there on that side of the map. Meanwhile, Mr. Rawls headed down towards red buff. Thought he might be getting that given over to him, but apparently not. Impaler will just smite that away.
So in my mind, the first big objective fight we're going to see will be around the dragon. And I think Rocket may be more inclined to initiate that move because of the fact that they have Elise, because Elise is very, very strong at taking the dragon early on. But the question is, do they do it by pulling Celeborn Vander down to help them, or do they try and put Jankos in the top lane for a gank to get the tower? Oftentimes, you'll only see that sort of dragon engage once a tower objective has been secured and you've got the numbers advantage. So we need to see what the question is. For the time being, Rocket is going to go for an early invade. Impaler does have smite, and again, he didn't have it previously. He's going to pick a fight, though.
Yeah, going to throw down his ultimate here. He's going to have Orianna coming down. Mimer will join in as well. There is the Dragon's Ascent over the side of the wall, and Jankos going to be the target here, but I think he's got the speed, thanks to Lulu, to actually get away from it. The shield mitigating some of that damage, and it's a nice blue steal, forcing out two ultimates there from the opposition.
Not going to be available if any further objectives come to play. So Rocket, with the first aggressive move of the game, and they come out ahead, securing that objective, denying it from Selfie. He does have the Chalice of Harmony, though, and he has got a tiny, tiny CS lead of Overpass. So he's doing well enough, but once Overpass gets his hands on that Ancient Golem buff, he's going to be able to punish Selfie a little more. We'll see who gets his big raid.
And Overpass. Nicely done there. Moving in, throwing him up with the Satchel Charge and finishing off there with the bomb as well. So nice little move from Overpower. As you mentioned, a little bit behind in CS in this lane by now. Also want to just point out the AD carry totals, because there is a bit of a disparity already working out. Celeva does have the advantage. Got a BF sword start, as we also see from Mr. Rawls.
Yeah, so it's actually an interesting start to this game, because neither team is looking to punish an opponent. Jankos and Impaler have not been particularly gank heavy, which is somewhat expected on an Evelynn. But when you look at Jankos, he's farming up very well, 40 CS. He's already finished his Spirit of the Ancient Golem. And we talked about how Rocket are going to be relying on Celeborn for damage. There's a very big indicator that Jankos wants to be a tank. Well, they're going to go on Zazzus again. He's almost got Flash.
Yeah, no ultimate here for Impaler, though. And I have to feel that they're not really going to get much out of that one. His Flash just coming off cooldown. And look at this. Rocket moving straight in towards the Dragon with Morgana and Jinx coming through. Lulu pushed up in the lane as well. I don't see anyone challenging from this Vander. He's just going to go up there and put a ward down into the Tri-Bush, which will spot one of them coming through. Impaler, of course, invisible. First Dragon in the game going over to Rocket.
They can go for a tower dive as well. They've got enough members on this bottom lane. Elise can juggle the aggro very effectively. Look for the cocoon. If it lands, they're going to go in.
And they do land it onto Impaler this time. The aggro actually from that Tori went onto Celeva, though, so not really able to do much, at least for now, in this bottom lane. Good damage into the turret, but I think between Elise and Shyvana, between Evelynn and Shyvana, they may be able to clear things out. There was a TP from Zazzus onto the top lane as well to try and hold his turret. Rocket looking for the first tower of the game. They're going to get it as well as a dot binding, landing onto Impaler. They chain the CC, and Jankos gets that kill. Super Mega Death Rocket came through, but wasn't even needed. It's a nice pickup for Rocket with a tower and a kill.
Dragon, kill, and the tower, all stemming from Rocket making the decision to go for the objective. They pulled Celeborn Vander away once the wave in the top lane was pushing to the Super Hawk crew. Mimer's been caught.
He's been caught. I think he's tanky enough at this point, and Celeva was taking damage from the turret, so decided not to go in there, as the Mega Inferno Bomb was actually used there by Overpower just to clear out this top lane and give a little bit less pressure on Zazzus' side, and also really bring Overpower back when it comes to the farm, because he's starting to lose out. However, Rocket still have three men. There is now a three-man reply from the Super Hawk crew. This should be enough to defend this turret.
They're going to hold this one off. What I really like about how Rocket have pulled this very nice lead in the early game is they made the conscientious decision to force the minion wave in the top lane, then pull Celeborn Vander down to this bottom lane for support. And we talked about how with Elise on your team composition, you've got superior dragon control in the early game. So they took advantage of it. They made the play, then they punished to get a tower. So I really like the decision making from Rocket, but Super Hawk crew haven't done anything to try interrupt them. Super Hawk crew have been very passive in this laning phase, and they've given Rocket the time to make an informed decision.
Seeing the first items actually coming out now as well with that gold lead for Rockout. Bloodthirster is done for Selva, whilst Mr. Riles only got the ingredients for that one and not finishing it off. We see the Athene's Unholy Grail is finished already in the mid lane for Selfie. Not quite done on Overpower's side, but I'm guessing that he's sat on a decent chunk of gold. And look at this, Rockout moving from that bottom lane straight into the mid lane. Super Hot Crew had recalled from there and they get a free turret.
That shouldn't happen. I mean, Selfie backed away. Rocket happened to make the move for the middle lane literally as Selfie had moved away. So a little unfortunate for the Super Hot Crew, but you do have to give credit to Rocket. They made the aggressive move. They've secured the second tower of the game. And Impaler is sniffing around. It's very clear Impaler wants to try shut Zazzus down. This is the third gank. We'll see if this one works.
Wow, he's got Wild Growth available. He's got Flash available. And there is the Wild Growth. Will knock both of them up, even putting down a good return on the damage towards Impaler. Blue buff again is going to be stolen away by Rockout. Second time in a row that Jankos will smite that one out for the victory. They may, however, lose it to it. But Impaler is actually tanking it up here. It goes very, very low. Almost being finished off.
Throw down the
tunnel. That was really, really well done from Impaler.
Impaler was so close to being taken up by that Glitter Lance. Very, very close indeed. Manages to sidestep it at the last second. Tower was secured in exchange for a blue buff, but Rocket have set their sights on the inner turret. There is support from Super Hot Crew, and that's the wave clear of the Orianna. Able to not only clear the minions, but prevent Rocket getting closer. Selva needs to have more ranks in that queue. Just see how he's doing before he tries to siege up those towers. But for the time being, Rocket, a very commanding start to this game.
Looking incredibly strong, and this is a Rockout, maybe we could say, of the spring split that surprised everyone in where they managed to finish, trying to put down some damage here on towards that middle outer turret, but sufficient cover already there with Overpower, Selva, and Jankos all coming in to make sure that there was no damage done onto that middle outer turret, and that leaves Rockout with the lead on multiple fronts here. A bit of ward clearing out as Vander will spot the pink that's in that death brush. And a little bit nervous about sticking around to finish it off. I think he didn't quite have vision of everywhere else, but not a problem really. Blue Wolf also spawning on the Rockout side of the map. Let's not forget that Jankos stole the last couple away from the Super Hot Crew, and Overpower will get his own. So thorough buff control here from the Rockout side.
So the question is, who's going to make the move for the next dragon? I think that's going to be the focus for Rockout, and that could be the opportunity for the Super Hot Crew to regain some footing in this matchup. If the Super Hot Crew can get Rockout to clump up together and land a strong shockwave with Evelynn or with Shyvana, that's how they can get back in the game. But for the time being, Super Hot Crew are nowhere to be found. This is the third tower they've given up, undefended. Two of them back to back, just not responding and not respecting Rockout's rotation.
And they need to move quickly here. They've only got Maimon defending this top wave. There's a siege minion in there as well. They've got a lot of damage. This is four men from Rockout pushing on through. They're going to send Weevil Failure up there, but he's really not going to offer too much. And Rockout get his second turret in the top lane, completely uncontested. Mr. Riles should be able to get rid of this outer turret in the bottom lane here, but Rockout having a bit of an easy time here pushing those turrets through.
20 seconds until Dragon. Super Hot Crew do grab a tower out of the deal, but they've lost an inner turret. We've seen a few interesting things. Mimus grabs himself a Banshee's Veil as his first big item collection. And I do think that's a great Mega Inferno Bomb from Inferno, from Overpower. I do think that the Super Hot Crew are waiting. They've got a team fight composition. They want to be flanking. They want Orianna to hit multiple Rocket members. But Orianna needs time before she can shred people and destroy people. And Super Hot Crew have just taken too long to try and pull the trigger. So let's see, they've started the dragon off. Look for Vander to land a good dark binding. That'll be their initiation.
That's a good box going down though from Weevil Failure. It'll stop them coming in and allow the dragon to go over to the Super Hot Crew. We know Zaza's TP'd in for that one. Maimer also teleported down towards the dragon area. Should a fight have broken out, didn't happen. The Super Hot Crew get a dragon pack. That's vital at this stage for keeping them in the game.
Yeah, it really, really is. And the way Rocket are playing, they didn't want the team fight. I think Rocket recognize and appreciate that in a straight up head-to-head 5v5, their team comp will most likely just get run over, will just get trampled by Evelynn, by Shyvana, and then the Orianna ball on top of them. So instead of putting themselves into a team fight, which they would probably have lost at that stage in the game, they give the dragon up. It is a smart decision. The thing is, now Rocket have got the most difficult task of breaking that inner line of turrets. They've caught Super Hot Crew out, but it should, in theory, be easier to defend the mid and the bottom inner turrets with some vision, with some warding. And you can see we will fail on counter warding duty.
Look at that statistic. 5 blue buffs, 4 Rockat, 1 for the Super Hot Crew, which is not a good statistic to have. Azazel's going to come in here. They get this low on Selfie. They knock him up as well, but have they got the damage to finish off? Shield comes in from We Will Fail It. In the end, not able to finish off Selfie. But look at this. It's allowed Rockat to put the pressure back on towards the bottom lane where Mr. Roz is trying to clear out. Will dash away from the traps there. And it doesn't matter either way. They've managed to get that inner turret. And you were talking about that, the hard inner turret line. Usually hard to break through, but the fact is Rockat putting pressure on middle, forcing the Super Hot Crew to move around with a wave pushing with them in the bottom lane, and Rockat moves so well across the map for that.
They are doing a very, very good job of playing the map in this matchup. And had the Super Hot Crew locked in a Twisted Fate instead of an Orianna in the laning phase, they would have had the Destiny available at this point to try and flank, to get the vision of their opponents and try to find those picks. Because Super Hot Crew have got a teamfight comp, if they can't get Rockat to group up together in 3, 4, 5 members, I think they'll be very hesitant to start a teamfight. So smart play from Rockat, Zazzus and Overpass zone, and the rest of the team go for the objectives. Let's see if they can keep this tug of war with Super Hot Crew, pull them to one side of the map, grab an objective elsewhere.
And Jankos actually just took another blue buff away from the Super Hot Crew, continuing that trend of really problematic buff control out of the Super Hot Crew. Not really had anything for Selfie to work with in this game. See that Selva backing away will take the red buff from the Rockat side of the map. I'm guessing that he's actually sat on a decent amount of gold here to go home and spend. Bloodthirster was complete earlier. Got himself Berserker Greaves in there as well. So we'll see exactly where Selva decides to go next in terms of his item build.
Yeah, he's a little bit of CS behind Mr. Riles. That is, of course, a symptom of moving around the map and playing the rotation game. He hasn't been sitting in a single location long enough. Pela almost gets caught out. But again, we're getting closer to Dragon respawning. The previous one was secured by Super Hot Crew, uncontested by Rockat. And I think Rockat have built themselves up a nice lead, but they're not exactly, you know, so clearly ahead that they can just instantly win team fights. It is only 2,000 or 3,000 gold right now, which is not a massive amount. But look at Jankos' build. He's got Aegis of the Legion as a second item. He's playing full support tank jungler. He wants to be the front line. He wants to annoy and interrupt Super Hot Crew as long as possible, just further adding to this, you know, sort of protect the Jinx sort of comp that Rockat have put together.
We said earlier the ideal scenario with Evelynn, come around the back of people, flank the team. There's been no full-on team fights here out of Rockat. They've only got 2 kills to their name right now, one of which came after about a minute's play in this matchup, which shows you how slow it's been in terms of Rockat wanting to team fight, even with the lead. But the fact is, Impaler's not really had much of an impact. He forced a flash from Zazzus, and that's about it. But look at this, slow gonna come down. Here's the ulti out of Fanda. I think they're gonna be able to lock up Mima. No, he flashes last second there before the ulti procs, but Selva now will be forced to flash on his own. Good job, Burns, but the hook lands. The flame will come in, and Selva is gonna go down. That's a nice pickup for the Super Hot Crew.
Very, very nice pickup. We Will Fail as flash hooks have been very good. He did that against Fnatic as well, if memory serves, flashing over tidal waves and getting the CC. What I like from the Super Hot Crew is they've instantly responded. Not only did they get the kill, they've come back to defend a tower. So, oh, they've caught Overpower.
They've caught Overpower out there with the hook, but no real follow through because Selfie had already been CC'd up at the back with a good binding coming out. Meanwhile, Zazzus putting down some pressure, and they're zoning them out really, really nicely here, and that's the problem. This Ziggs getting ahead, got a lot of damage already with the Athenes, with the Void Staff, got a needlessly large rod in there as well. He's hard to stick around when Ziggs is there.
There is 1 minute until Dragon. So the Super Hot Crew with the kill, it came a little early. They weren't able to transition from a kill to the objective. So what they have done is got a few extra wards in the river, but the Rockat vision is superior to Super Hot Crew at this point in time. Teleports are available, so for this next Dragon engagement, it looks like Rockat are moving into position. It looks like they're trying to get wards down to predict where the Super Hot Crew are moving in and then securing that objective, because there are, again, it's only 2,000 gold, and the longer Rockat waits, the more likely Super Hot Crew are to find an opportunity to flank. That's a good binding.
That is a very strong binding. had shields coming out though, so preventing most of the damage follow-up that came from Rocket. However, they are the team that have the position there by Dragon, which will be coming up in just a couple of seconds. And once that is actually there, we'll see if Rocket are just going to go straight in and take it. They've got four men there, as you mentioned. Crucially, TPs are up for both Mima and Zazzas. Dragon going to be started here by Rocket.
Yeah, Mima's closer, so he's not going to need the channel time of teleport to get in range. Rocket are split up. Jankos and Selvar are trying to rush the objective down, while Impaler wants to sneak it away. Let's see how far Zazzas can get. He's teleporting in.
Teleporting right to the front. Mima is in the thick of it as well, but I think the Super Hot Crew are going to be pushed away from this one. I think the Dragon actually did reset there, so he's going to have to be worked down from full HP. Once again, they managed to catch out Impaler. Is he going to go down? The bomb comes through. Loss of damage coming in, but Mima right in the middle of the team will actually have to ulti himself out of there. In the end, it's Mr. Riles that gets the kill. There's the shockwave coming in. Overpower goes low. They can't quite finish him, and they turn it around on towards Selfie. Selfie got himself the kill before going down, though. That leaves us at a 1v1. The hook on to Selvar, but We Will Failer will pull him into a death. Does go down in the end. That was the ignite from We Will Failer, and it will be a 3-for-2 overall there in favor of the Super Hot Crew.
We Will Failer lands a very crucial hook, which allows the Super Hot Crew to get that extra kill with the last tick of that ignite. The one thing I want to give highlight to is Rocket had actually started the fight incredibly, incredibly well. They did not present themselves as a five-man unit to get caught by a shockwave. Now, as Mima coming in with the TP, that's a very quick back away. Zazzas does not want any of that. Jankos is sticking around. Let's see who's going to get the dragon. Doesn't look like Jankos. Or maybe he does. Flash and smite.
Oh.
Joe's not over yet.
You have to be real careful because Impaler's low and he's going to get bound up. There is the kill. Jankos will get that one. The dragon really baiting the minion, but Zazzas will also die. Mr. Rawls gets that kill. Will they stick around here for dragon? I can imagine so. They've got Orianna who will finally get a blue buff of his own. Thresh coming down as well. The support crew going to have the numbers advantage by dragon. Let's have a little look at that one.
What I really liked about how this fight started is Rocket kept themselves split up. So the power of Super Hot Crew is reduced because they can't hit multiple targets. You've got Vanden Overpower zoning from the left. You've got Zazzas zoning from the right. And it was only once Jankos got sort of found a pick onto Impaler that the team fight really broke off. But again, look at Super Hot Crew. They want to be grouped up. They want to be fighting as a team. And they didn't get the opportunity to do so. Great culling on the fallback from Mr. Wells. Yeah. Landed that last killing blow, and look at the death sentence from We Will Failer. Holding Selvar in place, and Mr. Riles and Mima just going to get that last bit of auto attack damage. Ignite gets the kill.
The minions helping out with that one as well. So where does that leave us? We're 25 minutes into this game. We're tied 5-all in kills, but 5-2 in towers for Rockeye. It's giving them about 2,300 in the gold lead. Let's have a look now if that changes, because Dragon has been started. Super Hot Crew are too slow to react to this one. Rocket get themselves another one. 2 out of 3 so far.
Yeah, very well played. You did also highlight the fact that Selfie got his hands on that blue buff a few minutes ago. That's actually the first blue buff that he's got his hands on in a long time. They picked another fight. They've caught Selfie.
And Selfie's in no man's land, but again, a good lantern from We Will Failer will allow him to get back a lot of shields on both sides of the map. We saw it during that last fight that it looked as though Impaler was going to die. Then he got shield after shield. So many heals came in onto him, and he was able to stick around for it. Here's another blue buff spawning in, which will go to Overpower. But Rocket, the team that are still in control, but these team fights still not a done deal.
No, they're definitely not. What I do like is that Super Hot Crew, Rocket, are actually playing their comp very well. They're not putting themselves in a position where Super Hot Crew can punish them. And as this game continues to grow, we're going to see whose late game decision making is going to reign supreme. What I like about Super Hot Crew's trinkets options, they've got 3 reds and a blue, which is, in my mind right now, more about the defensive play. They need to clear out the wards in their jungle because Rocket have spent a massive amount of time moving through Super Hot Crew's jungle. So whereas yesterday we've seen all those reds being used aggressively for Fnatic, today it's more defensive for Super Hot Crew. They don't want to be caught off guard. They don't want to be surprised. Rocket, on the other hand, they want to clear the vision. They want to come from the sidelines. Landed good Dark Binding, landed Glitter Lance, which will allow Selvar to get all of his damage down because he's almost got that last Whisper completed. And we've already seen how quickly he melts towers and melts dragons.
So, Super Hot Crew could do with a couple of towers here. Middle outer turret still not down for them, such a crucial one. Definitely the most important on the outer ring of turrets overall. Not even being able to really do much damage, but they are starting to settle in around that one as Overpower's like, yeah, I just farm them from a distance while you're trying to take them away as well.
Yeah, nice try. Nice try. But Overpower secures it. CSY and Subaku are doing a better job. They've definitely held higher numbers, but the goal difference between the two AD carries is definitely swinging over time. Mr. Rolls, for the time being, if you look towards the right-hand side of that graph, it actually is a lot even, a lot closer than it was a few moments ago, thanks to the Dragon. You know, Rocket did grab themselves a Dragon. It is worth a lot more as the average level is climbing. And Rocket, we talked about how difficult it is to get to those inner turrets. They snuck the bottom inner turret, but they haven't caught Super Hawk unawares since then, so they haven't touched the middle inner turret.
Yeah, also on those grass, gotta keep in mind the numbers on the left-hand side, because that wasn't, even though those screens look huge, not a massive amount of gold in there. And of course, a 2-0-2 for Mr. Rolls compared to the 0-2-3 of Seliver certainly going to be helping out, as we may have a fight kicking off. The Binding landing on towards Impaler. Wild Growth comes in, but not doing a massive amount. But there's the bomb to the backside. Mr. Rolls catches a bouncing bomb as well. Super Mega Death Rocket not going to do a whole lot. Impaler will take the lantern away, and a lot used in that fight, but no one goes down.
Very smart from Rocket again. They have the fight on two fronts. They keep Super Haku split up, and it means that Selfie needs to make a decision. Do I use a less effective Shockwave on only one or two members, or do I hold it? But as Rocket grouped up the fight, they didn't chase. They start the Baron, but Impaler's in trouble.
Impaler's dead. Zazas will get that kill, and the Baron, as you said, already started. Seliver and Zazas, the two men that will be trying to keep them away, of course. Does have the range to get through. Is Selfie gonna bounce around thanks to Overpower, who's trying to get in? There's a Shockwave. Will manage to get Seliver, but he flashes into the Baron pit. And look at Baron. He's not taken all that much damage. Finally, they will be on it with four men. Only one man trying to keep them away. Baron gonna go low. Mimer now moving in. Selfie and Mr. Rawls there as well. Baron is still alive and still doing damage to Rockat. A last second repel comes out of Jankos, the shield as well, stopping all that damage coming in, and a massive brawl around the Baron. Baron doesn't go down. No kills apart from the initial one onto Impaler, who got caught flat out.
Without Seliver being dedicated on that Baron, that was always going to take a long time. Jankos has built full tank. He doesn't have a lot of damage to burn through Baron, which is why we looked at that for 30 or 40 seconds. It ends up being a single kill in favor of Rocket. And what Rocket did do effectively is force the Super Hawk Crew's hand. They did make Super Hawk Crew come to them, but what they didn't do was respond as well. Seliver was somewhat unsure. He was standing on the outside of the pit with the rocket launcher, as opposed to being with the minigun inside the pit to secure the objective. So Super Hawk Crew come away, I think, making the best of a bad situation. They only lost one, and the objective is still there to be contested.
Good stuff, really, overall. And as you said, it was the lack of damage that kind of caught me out there. I thought Rockout were going to be doing the Baron a lot quicker than he was actually going down. Probably gave Super Hawk Crew a bit of a lifeline there, because they did come in a little bit later to that one. Either way, Baron not going to be the focus just for now. There's a lot of wards on it from Rockout. They are, however, sending Zazas towards this bottom lane. Again, take note of the teleports. Both top laners do have teleports available, so Mimer will probably be the one that's sent to deal with Zazas wherever he goes.
So the Super Hawk Crew need to lull Rocket into a sense of security. If the Super Hawk Crew can get some vision down around the map, like that's a great mid lane ward that we just scrolled over, it will allow the Super Hawk Crew to look for opportunities to flank. For anybody who watches the North American LCS, last week, Cloud9 was blue side, they were playing against CLG, who were red side, and Cloud9 pushed up the middle lane. They were feeling very confident. They had five of the members just going to the inner turret in a very similar situation to what we see Rocket in right now. And it allowed Dexter to get a perfect five-man flank with Evelynn. That's what Super Hawk Crew want to do. Not necessarily in the mid lane, it could be around Baron, it could be around Dragon, but it all stems from vision. If Super Hawk Crew don't have that information, they can't make the flank.
And here we have the Dragon being done. As I said before, both TPs are available to come into this one. However, Lulu is already joining the fight. So Rockout, going to get this one started, or are they? Are they going to try and make a play on the inner turret? We see that Super Hawk Crew, oh, Selfie getting caught out there off to the side, and there's a lot of CC. Don't make a mistake here. Rockout got the chompers to go down after a cocoon lands. after we see a dark binding landing. If one of those hits, it's going to be followed up completely with a big chain. Mime is actually trying to get rid of Pink Wards here, which may become a problem or not.
That wasn't
Overpower
worth it.
Could knock him away.
That wasn't worth it. He's been forced to use Dragon's Descent before Baron's up. There's no Shockwave, but there is still Smite. Look at Rocket. They're focusing it down with that minigun of Celebar and Super Crew. I think they want a challenge.
Going pretty quickly. We will fail off to the back. Mime trying to run interference on the front side,
Dragon's
but they're
off.
Keeping him away from this one. There is a binding going through on towards him. Fail of the bomb will follow through. Overpower able to pick that one up. The Baron not being regen, and there is the pickup. Rocket get the first Baron of the game. Will he chase on for more kills? I think the Super Octo already in a safe distance away, but Rocket working hard for that one, but playing it perfectly.
Selfie's going to need to take a good, long, hard look at himself for getting caught out in that position. They were split away from the rest of his team. The Super Octo can't afford to take those small skirmishes. Because of the power of Lulu with Glitter Lance and the Morgana binding, that's a 3-second CC on the Dark Binding. Rocket with Baron have taken 50% of the tower off in this mid-turret, and I think they're going to stick around. They've got minions in the top lane that they can switch around to, and they just need to deal with the minions in the bottom lane if they want to continue playing all three.
And we see Ziggs just being a constant problem. Is Selfie going to get another binding right on top of him? The Lantern went down to offer him some support. Dragon, by the way, is live here, so Rocket are just going to simply back away from that middle inner turret that they've just taken and have themselves an easy Dragon pickup. And this is where the game gets a little bit out of control. The Super Octo are trying to hold it in, but then you lose a Baron. A tower goes straight after a couple of kills mixed in. Then you lose the Dragon on top of it, and we start closing in on 10,000 gold.
If Rocket did not have Baron and a 7,000 gold lead, I would actually say that the Super Hot Crew now have the possibility to get good positional plays. Because Rocket, in order to seize those inhibitor turrets, have to fully commit. They need to get the poke from Ziggs down, the poke from Lulu, and they need to be pushed up very, very deep in the lane. Super Hot Crew are going to be cheeky, steal away that last outer turret, just let Mima tank it up. And that's just catching Rocket a little off guard. Rocket, of course, recalling from the Dragon. So for the Super Hot Crew, the name of the game is look for the opportunity to punish Rocket on an aggressive move. Because Super Crew are behind in gold, behind in Baron, if they make an aggressive play, they can get punished and really fall further behind. Whereas if they wait for Rocket to make a move, Super Crew have the option, dive in, get a good shockwave. We still haven't seen Selfie hit more than one target with a shockwave.
And being caught out a couple of times here as well, not having the most comfortable of games, that's for sure. And look at this, Rocket getting up to the steps of that inhibitor turret in the mid lane. In fact, a little bit split up here. Jankos is trying to fend off both Mima and Impaler, doing a good job of it as well. And the question now is, can Rocket hold on to this turret with the constant pressure of Ziggs bouncing those bombs to the back?
Look at the vision around this middle lane. Rocket are so confident in their play. They've got pink wards behind them and to the left. So if Evelynn wants to come through that side, she's going to be revealed. Impaler's not going to surprise Rocket. So this is very intelligent play from a Rocket. They're using the range to their advantage. Overpower actually just used his Mega Inferno Bomb to kill some of the minions. He killed Weavilfailer with a Mega Inferno Bomb from the back line. So strong play. Let's see what they can do with it.
Oh, Impaler actually getting a little bit caught out. There's a shockwave. We'll drag two of them in, but the tanky is too with that Wild Growth on. Impaler will just get away from that one. Barely any health remaining, and now Rocket just going to tank up this turret. Selfie will be forced to back away, and they brute force their way through. Didn't even see that we will fail a kill, by the way. So a 5 versus 4 always going to give them a bit of an advantage. But I also have to question then, is 5 versus 4, why start a fight?
Yeah, desperation play. You know, if Super Hot Crew had surprised them and got a kill with Impaler or Mime or something, it would have worked out. I think this is just the poke. So Satchel, let's just see, bouncing. And Mega Inferno Bomb. Here we go.
Wow.
Dead center.
That's impressive from Overpower, playing that one completely blind.
You know what? I actually think Weavilfailer had Flash available, and I would dare argue he was watching middle lane. I would dare say he was looking, saying, what's the rest of the team doing? Because I would not have anticipated the Mega Inferno Bomb for that play. But it worked out, and this is why Overpower first picked that Ziggs. 312, 320 CS, and he's had some very good Mega Infernos. He's controlled the waves and he's just grabbed kills left, right, and center.
They also come decisively quick. We obviously get the forewarning in as a spectator, but for them, it's sometimes a little bit touch and go. They may have felt, even if I flash away here, I'm not going to have that for later if I want to make a play or even escape when it's a 5v5. Either way, it leaves Rockat solidly in the lead, and as I said, that 10,000 gold lead is about to hit 61.3 to 51.9 in favor of Rockat. 7-3 up in turret. It's got the leading kill as well. The question now is, what are the Super Hot Crew going to try and do to stay in this game? One thing that's now working in their favor, or I can't really say working in their favor, but it's not as much of a problem anymore, is the fact that the Baron buff has ran out for Rockat.
Yeah, it'll only be a couple of minutes before it's available again, though, and Rockat have played very patiently and they've played very controlled. They've made very minimal misplays and mistakes, and every time they have made a push or a move towards an objective, it has been very well informed. They've had very good vision at all stages of this game to deal with Evelynn and to deal with Mimer on Shyvana. Because again, if you have wards fanned out around you, you're less likely to be caught, you know, off guard, caught surprised. Mimer, for the moment, is actually very deep in this lane without vision. And I'm not sure if Rocket are looking for a kill. I think they're just trying to get some wards down themselves. They don't want to invest everything in killing Mimer and then have nothing for a team fight.
Yeah, they're moving into a classic split push position again. We see Zazas going towards his top lane. He's going to push that one all the way out. The rest of the Rockat team moving up through that middle lane here. The Super Hot Crew, of course, are going to at some point have to reply to this one using Mime, who's still got his teleport available, but it's one of those slowly but surely things here for Rockat. Step forward from Celeva, take a couple of hits down onto the turret. They've got super minions moving up the mid lane now as well, so the pressure's starting to build for the Super Hot Crew.
And, you know, this is Rockat just catching everybody by surprise. Nobody would have expected Rockat to have this level of intelligence and strategic movement in comparison to last week's game. So, you know, coming out of the dark yesterday, having not seen them play, this is a very positive upswing for Rockat. They handled the, you know, early laning phase well. They made the first aggressive moves towards Dragon. And they've taken so many towers just under the noses of Super Hot Crew, punishing them for not being able to defend. And Rockat have done a very good job, so you have to commend them on the strategic play. Let's see how they break this final set of towers. Even the Dark Binding is great. Oh, Weavilfailer has gone in.
Oh, it follows through there just as that back shield actually will time out, but Weavilfailer is going to die here, no question about that. Mimer right in the middle doing a good job, but Celeva getting away to the back and therefore to safety as the bomb comes through. Sidestepped by most of them. Mimer will go low. There's a flash cocoon from Jankos. Gets the finisher as well. He's down a rampage. The selfie gets caught out. Bounce back through, and look at that. Three men instantly knocked down by Rockat. This is going to give them a second inhibitor of the game.
This could be the game. There are super minions on the Nexus turret, and Rockat may look to finish.
Pushing through here, as I said before, a vital win for Rockat if they can pick this one up. Mr. Ross trying his best to defend now, just dashing away from that Dark Binding. There is the first turret going down. Mr. Ross going to be chasing Celeva, going very deep on that one. It's not really going to matter. They've got Zazas, I think. Oh no, it's Celeva. I don't even know. One of them tanking up those turrets, and there is the Nexus now going to be focused down. Overpower looking for a final kill that he doesn't get. It doesn't matter though, because Rockat have managed to take down the Super Hot Crew.
Very, very coordinated play from Rockat. And I'm thoroughly impressed with their decision making. This is a night and day turnaround from last week, where against Alliance, they struggled to take advantage of their early lead and early game. And this time around, there was very little hesitation. Just very intelligent decision making. They challenged for the right objectives, and they punished when Super Hot Crew went.
And we said that the fact that they didn't play yesterday, that they got that forfeit win over the Copenhagen Wolves, may have given them some advantage, more time to prepare for the Super Hot Crew to watch their game yesterday, and also not allow the Super Hot Crew to have one more game to watch, to research, to figure out exactly how Rockat are going to come into this one. And honestly, that looks like a completely different team to what we've seen in the first 3 weeks.
Yeah, I completely agree with you, and I think every single member of the team was integral to helping out. We see great wild growth from Little Lancers. Jankos had superb ganks. Overpower, I mean, that was a first pick insta-lock Ziggs. It was the quickest champion of the entire pick and ban phase, and it completely worked out. Overpower was just everywhere. And I, For me, the biggest commendation is just on how Rocket moved from tower to tower in like the 10 to say 20, 25 minute mark before they hit a bit of a roadblock. They snuck towers, they had great vision, they were sieging mid lane, they had this ring of wards. It's just very good forethought and planning, and it feels like they've got a grasp of how to play the macro game with these compositions in this setup. And